This is in reference to Charles Blow's article in the New York Times on Monday, December 1st, 2014. God, the year's almost over. The title was Crime and Punishment. Of course, when I saw it, I had to read it. Because, let's see, it was Dostoevsky that wrote Crime and Punishment. And who was it? Tolstoy wrote War and Peace. So I didn't read War and Peace, but I read about half of Crime and Punishment. And I couldn't take it anymore because the guy was so guilty and he thought about it. It felt like me all the time. Just guilty, guilty, guilty. You know, it's that Irish guilt. Of course, I got the same way even when I read his much shorter stories, which was Notes from the Underground and The Dreams of a Ridiculous Man from back in the day. But Crime and Punishment, so Charles Blow goes in to talk about not only is there a discrepancy in terms of the number of blacks that are incarcerated, the amount of poverty and the poverty that is confined into certain neighborhoods, higher than, well, you know, that is a significant thing that's going on. And not only is it, but our perception of it, especially the white perception of black crime, is much higher than what it really is. So Charles goes into the fact that, you know, the overall crime rate has been going down since the 1990s. And of course, you could argue we're having more of a police state, but that's for another day. And that then there's been numerous studies about how a much greater percentage of black people feel as if that they have been abused because of their race by police officers as opposed to whites. We also know that blacks are incarcerated at a much higher rate. We also know that they're much more likely to be stopped on the street for trivial types of things, to see similar to the stop and frisk type of thing. We also know, and not only are blacks incarcerated at much higher rates than whites, we know that the rate that they use drugs is approximately the same rate as what whites use drugs. But let's get back to it. So we have, a lot of white people have the perception that crime is actually going up, and that crime by black people is actually going up when it isn't. And of course, the studies show that when they're asked about that, people feel that blacks should be more, that they should be incarcerated. So we have this really strange dynamic where white, and of course that feeds into white fear, you know, that there's the black person out there, there's going to be the scary black man, as we talked about. Remember in The End of the Wire, in one of those seasons when Omar found Trevor Bell with some white guy, they were in some building project, Trevor Bell was trying to go legit, but Omar, who was a street thug, blew him away. And that was the end of that, I think that was the end of the season that year for The Wire. And then the cops were talking afterwards, did the guy see you shot him? Well, yeah, what was it? Well, you know, it was just another scary black man. And they had a big laugh because, you know, you see some black guy shooting another black guy and you get all scared and you can't describe the person at all. But the point was, is that that's the perception. It's a scary black man, and we're scared of blacks, even though crime has gone down, even though blacks are being incarcerated by a much greater extent, that blacks feel oppressed by the police at a much greater extent than white people. And we need to have, of course, he wants to have a discussion about it. I think the laws need to change. And of course, part of it is that, you know, if you're a black person, why would you want to get on a police force that oppresses black people? Now, I don't know what the statistics are in any cities or anything like that. I mean, there are many cities that are predominantly black. I don't know if there's a predominantly black police force out there or not on any of those cities. The laws need to change in terms of drugs. Laws need to change in terms of, you know, stop and frisk. Laws need to change in terms of what police are really allowed to do when they stop people for legitimate reasons. So those are all things that can be discussed. But then the overall aspect is, you know, we have to change the culture in a way. White people don't, you know, won't have the perception that every black person is out there to rob them. And that's just a terrible thing that's going on. I don't know why that perception is. I've worked in the projects. Of course, I'd be the first to admit I probably wouldn't walk around there at night. But I haven't been, but when I walked around the daytime, I had no fear at all. I had been stopped by cops saying, don't walk around by yourself. Don't carry any money in your wallet. You'll walk your wallet in your car. Stuff like, you know, just telling me, and then of course it was a white cop telling me that. See, he just wanted to tell me, you gotta be worried, you know. And I never had any troubles when I was working at a work down there for about 2 years or so. So, but there's terrible perception, and of course, we couch it in terms of we, I'm talking about Whitey, in terms of bad choices, not being a good person. We couch it in, there's no respect for the law, all of this kind of stuff to justify the greater incarceration, you know, of black people. And, you know, ghetto culture, the terrible slang, you know. And in the meantime, you know, we're not doing anything to help educate these people. We're not help doing anything to make sure that the kids have enough to eat so that they can be not distracted while they're going to school and learn things. So there's a lot to be said. Crime and punishment stuck me as a thing. And it is, yes, there's a disproportionate amount of punishment for crimes committed by blacks, but our perception is, the white perception is that that there is more crime, and that more crime is being committed by black people, and that's just not the case, and that's something that will take a long time for us to get over.